Welcome to our lunch symposium. It's my pleasure to welcome my colleague and friend, Professor Lutter, from University of Kiel. I'm very happy that he came today because he's one of the pioneers of mitral, transcatheter mitral valve implantation techniques. And so we will have today mainly transcatheter aortic valve implantation topics, but also some new aspects and insights of transcatheter mitral valve implantation. Okay, so maybe we changed the order of the program a little bit because Professor Zembala has another talk in a parallel session. So I will start, and then Michael Zembala, then Dr. Unic, and then the best one, Georg Lutter. Okay, so.
Thank you so much. Nice to be here. Dr. Matthias Thielmann will give us the first talk.
So my talk will be about the question if we, let's say, observe or if we can expand the limits of treating our patients with transcatheter techniques. So I can use this here, yes? Yeah. These are pretty recent data from Germany. I would like to show you because these data were surprising to me, showing in 2014 already more patients treated by transcatheter techniques than treated by surgical aortic valve replacement. And as you also may see is that the transfemoral approach is increasing while transapical remains at the same level. And also surgical aortic valve replacement seems to be stable so far, but this may change in the future. So there are different aspects in regards to expanding or to treat more patients, different patient clientele with TAVI. So the most discussed topic at the moment is if we should treat patients with intermediate or even low risk aortic stenosis. And this is just a little survey of our own patient in our hospital in Essen. And I just would like to show you if we consider intermediate risk patients with an STI score between 3 and 8 and or a logistic Euro score between 5 and 20, this is almost more than the half of all our patients. Together with the high risk and inoperable group, we are talking about now 85% of all patients with aortic stenosis. There are two trials, two important trials. The one is the PARTNER 2 trial. I will show you some very recent results. And the other is the SURTAVI trial. It's still ongoing. I have not seen any results so far. Of note, both trials are funded by companies. And I think it would be more than important that we also have a physician-initiated randomized trial, especially in this group of patients. We don't have. So this is the very recent paper published in New England Journal last or 2 weeks ago from Martin Leon. You all are aware of Martin Leon. The paper published the PARTNER 2 results, randomized intermediate risk patients either treated by a transcatheter or surgical aortic valve replacement. And just of note, and I would like to show you the limitations of this trial. Firstly, patients are still old, on average 81 years, and the STS score of 5.8 but, and I think this is a little bit unfair in this trial, they considered patients with 70% concomitant coronary artery disease, almost 25% post-CABG surgery and post-PCI, and for me, a high amount of patients with COPD and peripheral vascular disease. So I'm not sure if we are really talking about intermediate risk patients in this publication. But, and these are the results, if we look at the composite endpoint of death and disabling stroke, you can see that there's no inferiority of TAVI as compared to surgical aortic valve replacement. And if you just consider the transfemoral patients, there is even a superiority with a significantly better outcome for the TAVI group. So they came to their conclusion: in intermediate risk patients, TAVI was similar to surgical aortic valve replacement with respect to the primary endpoint. But I think we should really try to make clear that they also included patients with ascending aortic replacement, for example, so this is crazy. But yeah, that's how, this is a, just a little game for you. These are all patients, or mainly celebrities, with an intermediate risk. You see an 86-year-old male. If you calculate risk factors, he would have a logistic Euro score of 8, ST score of 4. So what are we doing? Of course, we would maybe consider him for TAVI. Next lady, 78-year-old female, ejection fraction slightly reduced to 40%, so she's also an intermediate risk patient. Okay, nowadays, maybe we would discuss in the heart team, also consider her for a TAVI. Next lady, 62, female, on dialysis with liver disease. She would have a calculated Euro score of 5%. What would you do? Oh no, the next one is Mr. Clinton. And he is really a post-CABG patient, 66-year-old, slightly reduced ejection fraction. So maybe he would, yeah, we would have a discussion today if we would do a TAVI or a classical surgical. So this gentleman is looking very, very, you would do a surgical AVR? Maybe. Okay, so, and just to demonstrate you, we are talking about very different types of patients. Even this gentleman here below, 46-year male, you would never consider him today for a TAVI, ejection fraction 30%. But if you go to Asia, they are discussing, well, why not? You know? Yeah. So then we go.
It's Karlsruhe, right? Karlsruhe, they all put in the TAVIs, right?
I don't know.
That's what I heard.
Really? Okay, next aspect of expanding the limits, it's already routine in the clinical treatment, mixed AS and coronary artery disease patients. We just compared in a retrospective propensity score analysis whether TAVI and PCI is as good as AVR and CABG, and we published that, and that's a small number of patients, but we did propensity score analysis, and there was no difference between outcome. So, yeah, maybe this is also the future. Then bicuspid aortic valves, how can we expand the limits there? Can we treat patients with bicuspid aortic valves? Interesting paper here showing the frequency of unicuspid, bicuspid, and tricuspid aortic valves in patients undergoing AVR. And as you can see, the younger the patients, the more patients you will find with bicuspid aortic valves. And this has an impact when you decide to treat younger patients. So there are some papers, and to date, 8 registries with a total of 381 patients reported. This is a paper by Pratz, published in JACC Cardiovascular Interventions. And in the most studies, bicuspid anatomy was associated with a higher rate of moderate to severe paravalvular leakages, in particular if valve sizing was solely on the basis of echo. So, okay, this information is something we would expect, but it's still unclear if we can treat patients with bicuspid aortic valves in the same quality as tricuspid valves. Well, patients with pure aortic regurgitation is another, I think, important aspect, and we have meanwhile treated in our center, we have an experience of now 12 patients where we put in a cymatis acrid valve. This is a self-expandable valve. And as you can see here, this is our experience. We started with a patient years after aortic surgery with severe aortic regurgitation, high Euroscore. And I will show you some examples. This is the gentleman, the first case. You see a severe aortic regurgitation after a modified Jakub, after aortic surgery with ascending aortic replacement. This is the implantation, just the pre-procedural angiography, and here you can see the valve implantation, self-expandable valve. It's a J-shaped stent, so this is why it seems to work very well to fix the valve in a non-calcified anatomy. And here you see the result. There is some leak. We still have the patient in the follow-up after now, I don't know, 2 or 3 years, but the situation is stable and he's asymptomatic again. This is another example, pure AR, no calcification at all, and you see a severe regurgitation, logistic Euroscore 40%. Here you see the angiography, and we put in a size S cymatis, and this is the result without any regurgitation. I think a pretty nice result. And the third example, this was a patient completely decompensated, coming as an emergency case in our hospital. You see BNP value above 2,500, having had a mitral valve replacement in 2006. So we decided, okay, our treatment option is limited, so we do the TAVI, and you see it works very well. This is the result. No AR, successful treatment. Patient is fine nowadays. And yes? Yes, that's all 12 patients is just with the cymatis self-expandable valve. I think an Edwards valve would never work, core valve also. And it's really important to say, to address that this is an off-label procedure, of course. So if you do something like that, it's not approved, okay? So this is the result. Where have we been? Ah, okay, though this is my last, just my last example. This was a patient I did during a live transmission meeting. So this was very exciting to me. You see there's no calcium at all in the CT preoperatively. And The advantage of this system is that you can resheath this valve. And you see, I try to position the valve, and it's slipping through the annulus, which is not good, of course. But it's possible to resheath. You see, I resheath and try to come back to the ascending aorta. Here's the deployment, so finally it went well, but with, 500 spectators, it was a little bit tough. But anyhow, these are the clinical outcomes and echo follow-up data. You see mortality was initially zero, VARC criteria, procedural success rate 100%. We had one death after 12 months. Within 12 months, patient died on lung cancer. And no stroke, no major bleeding, one acute kidney injury, no myocardial infarction. So pretty nice results. And these are 2 years results in regards of echo data. Still, I think, acceptable data, two mild ARs. Although this is an example which was not successful. It was a proctored case. The site was so nice and gave me their angiography. You see, this was an implantation which caused an embolization of the valve. And this is another case from the heart center in Völklingen in Germany. And they did the implantation in a pure AR in a shell high conduit. It's also possible, also a nice procedure. So last but not least, just some examples how to treat patients with valve and valve and valve and ring. You all are maybe familiar with that. Okay, the movies doesn't work. This is a transapical procedure in a mitral bioprosthesis. So, without any major leak. This is a transapical procedure, a TAVI, and this is a transition to the later talk of Mr. Lutter, in combination with a mitral. This is a double valve implantation, shortly. So this is also a very elegant procedure for those high-risk patients. Then in a mitral ring. So this is also very straightforward, half an hour procedure. So let me conclude. Dramatic continued growth of TAVI worldwide. Currently, the major indication is high risk and inoperable aortic stenosis. Heart team plays a major key role. Indication will or is already expanding. And of course, when the limitations like paravalvular leakage and long-term durability are proven. And this is my transition to Professor Lutter's talk. This is a case from Malte Sinning in Bonn. He did one of the first mitral, TAVI in mitral native calcified ring. And I know that many try to do that, so it's also, of course, off-label. It's a very dangerous procedure. And just those cases who went successfully, of course, are published, as every time. So please be careful in choosing such patients. I don't believe this is a good treatment option, but in this case, it's really nice to see that this may also work. Thank you very much.
Are there questions from the auditorium for this very interesting talk? So what we learned right now is to push the limits, right?
Yes.
that's what we always, every day, we try to do more or minimal invasive procedures. You presented here the most exciting TAVI procedures. So one question I do have, because I have a patient at home at Kiel who does have a very enlarged to 5 centimeters ascending aorta, and she needs, in pure AR, she needs a TAVI. So in my thoughts, I would have taken a Jena valve, but they thought it's possible to do. But due to the fact that the ascending is dilated, it's little risky. So would you suggest going to put a symmetis in, or do you think also because of the crown the symmetis has, that it's also very difficult to put in an enlarged ascending?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the question. To be honest, I don't know. The most important thing is in those patients is to do a proper sizing preoperatively. So you can't go into OR and do a TEE and say, oh, it will fit. But you need an absolutely precise sizing, which means if the annulus is more than 24, 25, then it's becoming very dangerous to put in a symmetis. If it's a woman, probably it's a smaller annulus. If the ascending aorta is dilated, it can be also a big annulus, and then put in a Jena valve, probably.
Yeah.
It's better.
Yeah, that's what I thought, because Jena valve has the clip towards the leaflets, and I think she's about 22 millimeters. But yeah, it's not that easy, because Jena valve also is approaching the ST junction and tries to put the crown inside, and this is missing in her then, and therefore you have to be very deep and very grippy towards the leaflet so that it gets stuck over there in the annulus. So sizing is very important. We did a CT and But are there any further questions, because we have to go ahead?
Yes, we have to go ahead, yeah. And we are very lucky and happy that Michael Zembala.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege and honor to be a speaker here during this TAVI session, and I feel honored, especially when I was chosen to talk about transfemoral TAVI in the hands of a surgeon. Well, why bother, someone could say? Is there a cardiologist among us, or is there anybody else performing transfemoral TAVI? I think, you know, our surgical community would ask, you know, why should we? This is the reason. You showed that slide before. In 2014, the estimated number of TAVIs in Germany was 8,000. It actually was much higher. It was 13,000, as Matthias showed us. And the expected number for 2015 is over 15,000. So this is an enormous number. And the market is driving these numbers even further. It's estimated that it will reach $3 billion in 2020. And Martin Lyon says that it will exceed the drug-eluting stent market in 2025. So this is enormous. Well, we've seen some innovations in cardiac valves, in the surgical valves, but not too many for the past 10 years. We've seen sutureless valves, but the adoption rate is just too slow, and the reimbursement rate is not that high. So it all turns the sutureless valves down. And at least to this point, we've been kind of protected by the guidelines, which said that the TAVI procedure can be performed only in a center that has a cardiac surgery on site. So you need a heart team, you need a cardiac surgeon, but look what's happening. And this is one of the preliminary reports. It says preliminary experience of a center that does not have cardiac surgery on site. And guess what? The results are not different at all. No higher mortality, no higher complication rate, it's all the same. So out of the sudden, I would just wait and look, because in the future guidelines, you'll have this probably. TAVI may be performed in a center without on-site cardiac surgery by an experienced operator. And since you have papers on that, you'll get the class 2B level of evidence, B indication. That means cardiac surgery will leave the subject of aortic stenosis for good. And we've seen that before with PCI versus CABG around early 2000, when bare metal stents were born, then drug-eluting stents were born, then bioresolvable scaffolds appeared at the market. You've seen that. with single vessel disease, triple vessel disease, now left main stenting. CABG is way down, and a PCI is really available. Same situation with surgical versus TAVI. Not much different. What is different is the adoption rate. It's so rapid that it reminds us a kind of a disruptive technology. Disruptive technology, it's a technology or device so successful that its success was not even anticipated by the maker. And even if the quality at the beginning is not great, it's good enough for the bottom end of the market and allows the maker to get into the market, profitable entry, and then by increasing the quality, putting resources, you upgrade it and you make it go higher up market, destroying every other device or technology that was available. Same happened with film and analog and digital cameras. Same happened with digital cameras and smartphones. And the same is probably going to happen with TAVI. Look at this. At the beginning, it was inoperable patients, so the bottom end of the market. No one cared about these patients, inoperable. But what happened, the industry was giving money and upgrading these devices, so we are now facing it with a high-risk patient. And now, partner two trial, although it's unbiased, it's a medium risk. And they're already, it's biased. There are already studies showing that the low-risk patient can be also treated safely with the TAVI device. And of course they're right, because if you perform and you start performing transfemoral TAVI, you notice that this procedure is just excellent. You can do 5 procedures during one day, and the patient is not put to sleep. The patient is awake. It's awake surgery. You can talk to the patient. Moreover, the patient goes home on the third post-operative day. So this is wonderful. This is undeniable. So what do we get? A cardiac surgeon who is in grief. And imagine a situation that you have a patient that is a lady that is 82-year-old after previous bypass surgery, right? She's severely diabetic, and you get to operate on her on Friday, 2 p.m. And you say, no, this is clearly a TAVI patient. I give it to cardiologists. I go home for a weekend. And thinking that probably on Monday you'll find her somewhere in the ICU intubated, well, you find, oh my God, the patient had survived. Okay, so you kind of think that they will not try it again. It's a denial, classical way. But oh my God, there's another survival. And after 100 of these cases, you start seeking for vein to weigh out. Can I try it? Can I do it? And they say, no. You disqualify these patients. They're ours. Right? So you are in depression. And this is the stage that most of the cardiac surgery centers are now, that they finally realize that it's inevitable. That's the way that it will move, no question. So we think that they will take them all. Well, so we start, we have to start getting it back. We got to start seeking for realistic solutions, and we can do it. Why? Well, we have to accept the change. We have to be realistic, but we have to go on and take that technology as well. How? Look at these knowledge-based kit cell level required for the TAVI procedure, so to say. Aortic valve anatomy and pathology, surgeon know it well. Interventional cardiologists, come on. They even make these devices for interventional cardiologists to see how the aortic valve looks like. Perioperative skills? For residents, probably. Perioperative skills, cardiac surgeon is better in this. Large bore sheet management, it says no. I would disagree. Most of us put large cannulas during the peripheral vessel cannulation. It's 21 French. TAVI devices are 14 French, so they're smaller. You can do it. We know transapical subclavian direct aortic access, it's easy for us because we know the field. Of course, we are not good in coronary instrumentation, guide wire manipulation and radiation protection, but that is not difficult. There are just a couple of wires to know and a couple of catheters to know. So I think in the future there will be a TAVI specialist that will combine these two, and we as a society and we as an environment should create a kind of a TAVI specialist field. So it's not a cardiac surgeon, it's not a cardiologist, it's someone in between with both skills. So let's convert that grief curve into a change curve, and let's experiment, spark motivation, communication, and share knowledge. How to build it, how to build a TAVI program. And these are just my thoughts. For those of you who want to start it, search for potential TAVI candidates. And we know we have these patients. Many times you open a chest and there's a porcelain aorta and you close the chest and you give the patient back to the cardiologist. Stay with this patient, have him and perform maybe a balloon valvuloplasty at the beginning. Talk to the TAVI representatives or device representatives. And with my experience, it's better sometimes to talk to small companies as they also are seeking for help because they're urgently trying to get into this market. Talk to the hospital administration who pays for the procedure. At least in Poland, it is a very strange situation because the TAVI procedures were reimbursed from cardiac surgery budget. And now what happened in the past that cardiologists were performing them. Why? Because cardiac surgeons didn't have any skills and wire skills. You know, they were too afraid that these patients are too difficult. So we're trying to regain our money, actually. Become independent. Learn CT evaluation, valve sizing, valve selection. You got to do it yourself. You cannot rely on anybody else, on cardiologists to size the valve, on radiologists to tell you how to position the C-arm. You got to learn these things. You got to learn which wire to use, and this is fairly simple. There are like three or four wires. This is if you can manage 10 sutures, three wires is nothing. Same with catheters. And also important to train nurses and perfusionists so you can replace these folks that come from cath lab so you don't have to ask or bargain for additional stuff to come and to perform that procedure with you. Start slowly but progress rapidly. Start with probably it's easiest to start with balloon valvuloplasty because you don't need a large bore sheet. You just need a simple balloon. You can do it. You can always say, you know, I had a patient, he was very symptomatic, I had to do it, if cardiology asks. You know, why did you do a balloon valvuloplasty? I had to do it. Start with the access that you know, either direct aortic or transapical. You can always convert a patient on the table, right? You were prepared to do a classical SVR, but the patient was difficult, so I decided to go transapically, okay. That's on-table decision, almost like in PCI. Choose the system which is user-friendly and forgiving. Matthias mentioned Symetis, and it's a perfect for starters, I think, because you can resheet the system, you can reposition the system, you can play with this, and it's almost like foolproof. Watch the game, don't get too happy, and we had that situation in the beginning after 10 or 12 procedures. We were so happy with the results that we forget to look for small bleeders, and we had to reopen the chest because we had some bleeding from the small intercostal artery. And then cardiologists came and said, "Oh, you guys have too many complications because you had to reopen the chest." So don't get too happy with this. Be careful. Improve the results, have a direct competitor. And this is something that I like personally. I'm very competitive. So in our institution, we have two teams, a cardiology team, purely cardiology with a core valve, and my team with the Symetis, transfemoral, transapical. And we like to compare each other. You know, you got like 35% pacemaker implantation rate, and we have 1% pacemaker implantation rate. Our patient go home, second post-op day. Your patient go home, fifth day. So it's always good for both teams to compete. When starting transfemoral, start with the cutdown. Don't play with these occluders. You can do the cut down. You've done so many times the peripheral vessel vascular cannulation. So it's easy to identify the vessel, so it's easy to put the cannula in. Why bother? The patient don't care about the incision. Talk to these patients. They don't care about the incision. They had so many surgeries in the past that if you do a 3-centimeter incision, 2-centimeter incision, or 10-centimeter incision, doesn't matter. Have the pump ready, safety net, and this is one of the key issues for the surgeons. The cardiologists don't know how to use the pump. Be open-minded, have a backup. It's not an ego game, so learn, teach. Have another colleague with you, so there are two of us. So if you go for a vacation, there's another one who is a backup. And notice small players on the market as they need your help to get there. And start with one, expand later. This is also our philosophy, as we do not have as many procedures and as many reimbursements for the procedure. So we chose one system. We wanted to be a proficient, error-proof, and expert in one, then move to another, and be ready for the criticism from both surgical and cardiology sites. Because you got to face it. You know, if you start performing TAVI and you talk to surgeons, they will start saying, okay, you're moving to the dark side. And if you start talking to cardiologists, they'll also say that you are crazy. You know, you are coming from the dark side. So you gotta prove that they're wrong. Prove by showing your results, sharing your complications, sharing your thoughts, and but showing the differences, but emphasizing similarities. So at the end, to come to this integration curve, spark motivation, develop capability, and share knowledge. Sharing knowledge is very important. So this community, cardiology community, will start treating you as one of their own. So I got to run, unfortunately, because I have another talk, and I'll be not staying for the discussion. But I want to show you this, as this is probably one of the key elements. It's a kind of a Star Wars between cardiac surgeon and cardiologist, and we are in the civil war, as it said. And look what Luke says. Yoda says.
You are reckless.
So was I, if you remember.
He is too old. Sometimes. Yes. Too old to begin the training.
But I've learned so much. I won't fail you. I'm not afraid.
You will be. You will be.
Thank you very much. So we come to our next topic. It's presented by my colleague, Professor Unic from Croatia, from Zagreb. His topic is development of a TAVI program in the Balkan region, which fits very good to this Congress.
Thank you, Dr. Thielmann. Ladies and gentlemen, it fits great to the Congress, I don't think it will be that positive as we saw just recently. We went through all these stages and then managed to set up a program. Although when it all started in 2002 with Dr. Alan Cribier, we were all, shocked. Because every cardiac surgeon who ever faced this thought there's no way that's going to work. But as it turned out, the patients are out there, as we learned from the Euro survey that almost 30% of patients with AS are left untreated for various reasons, although they do meet the guidelines. One of the main reasons was their age, their comorbidities, their referring doctors not knowing the current guidelines, or the patient simply refused to be treated in any way. That's very common in our region because, okay, I've lived a fruitful life, I'm old enough and don't do anything. or they had a contraindication for conventional surgery once they were referred to surgeons. What we learned that the procedure worked, the partner one trial showed us in both arms that for high-risk patients it worked. It even made the guidelines that should be undertaken with the, these are the last guidelines, but the new ones we'll see what they bring. So still we have here a multidisciplinary heart team, cardiac surgery on site. Whether or not that will change remains the question, as we saw in Michael's talk. What we saw also just recently, Dr. Thielmann showed you that intermediate risk, however biased the paper may be, take-home message is the one we're going to take from here. We'll forget about COPB, we'll forget about how many cabbages in that group and whether or not they are really intermediate risk, but the take-home message is it's the same thing for intermediate patients, and everything will move to intermediate patients. So we'll go from the situation, we're far, far from here actually now, and as in everything new, it starts with you're crazy, idiots, reckless, you're irresponsible, it works, but it's possible in inoperable patient too, you're a visionary and breakthrough, and this is a great procedure which everyone can do. And we'll, as a surgeon, we'll find ourselves in this situation pretty soon. How many patients are we looking at? These are from Jack, the numbers of yearly needs throughout Europe and the US and Canada for TAVI procedure projected. Once we project that at Croatia, which has about 4.5 million inhabitants, 0.5% should have aortic stenosis, so about 20,000 severe will be in 3,200, symptomatic severe in about 1,600. About 30% of those will not be suitable for AVR, so we come to about 500, and which will leave us then when we filter all out with about 200 TAVI candidates, or around 50 per million inhabitants. Where do we stand with the resources? Currently, we have 12, in Croatia, we have 12 cath labs, 6 cardiac surgery centers, and about 2,000 to 2,500 open heart surgeries per year. And TAVI is performed in 3 centers. One is our center, which was the first one to start and retain the program, University Hospital Center in Zagreb, which is in our neighboring institution, and University Hospital Center Rijeka. They have started, both centers have started just 2 years ago. How did we start? Actually, it's probably easier to get the infrastructures in the countries like ours than maintain the program which it was meant for. So we have a hybrid room since 2007, and we used it mainly for TVAR procedures and for some pacemakers, and our vascular surgeons used it. Until we formed a heart team in 2010, starting enrolling first patients, which were surgical patients who we deemed were too high of a risk once they were referred to us, and the first implants we did in 2011. And this is our experience so far. About 65 patients, and this is our AVR experience, and it's about from 10 to 20 patients per year, with a sharp drop last year, which when we did only 9, and this year we did only 1 just recently prior to coming here. What are the reasons for that? It's reimbursement. It's reimbursement, and whether or not it's everything is influenced by politics in these parts of the world. And I have to say that this was sharply influenced by elections at the end of the year. So nobody wanted to sign off for any reimbursement until let's see who comes in power. And then we have to consolidate again, so there's just one this year so far. How does it work? Where do we get our money from? Hospitals receive a monthly budget from the state-operated insurance company, which is filled by 15% of gross income of every person that works. It's free for a retired person, it's free for kids and up till the age of 18, And that covers all expenses. That includes our paychecks, that includes heating, that includes food for patients, medication, drugs, and also implantables, and also should include TAVI. Reimbursement is done via DRG for all procedures, but we don't have it for TAVI just yet. And this system collects about 3 billion euros per year to be spent on healthcare, and but also, unfortunately, generates about $400 to $500 million loss every year. So we have to change something. Reimbursement is a big problem. We are fighting for reimbursement because we can see, we can see that in the countries that are that have a DRG-specific reimbursement, penetration is very high. And the other alternative, funded on hospital budget, for instance, Spain and Ireland, less. For SAVR, we have something like this now in Croatia. So we have a DRG reimbursement for a surgical AVR, and the difference we should cover from our own hospital budget, from that limited budget that we receive. That's why we are trying to push for a complete DRG reimbursement of TAVI. And that's currently about $12,000 per surgical AVR, while TAVI costs are for Corval about $30,000 and for Sapien as well. The Ministry of Health has formed a specific transcatheter task force for transcatheter structural heart therapies. I'm a member of that. We had only two meetings. We have proposed also a complete proposal for the DRG TAVI related, so we are waiting to see what's going to happen. Because, this is a little bit blurred, but this slide shows healthcare expenditure per capita and implants per million people for TAVI. And you can see that it's a proportional risk. And the more you spend on healthcare, the more TAVIs you're going to put in. So where are we now? So we are about here. If we were to follow this line, parallel line, to the point where we should be, and that's about here, with the needs that we have for about 50 per million, it turns out that we should increase our healthcare spending about 20 to 30%. So I don't see that happening in the near future with the economy as it is, so we have to find the way around it, but to satisfy the needs of our patients. So these are just some of the problems. We have established the program. Michal gave you a perfect, we went through all that. He gave you a perfect intro to this talk. But now what we have to conclude is that TAVI is now an established method. It's not going away. So we as surgeons should be involved, and we are heavily involved because first of all, we have a hybrid room. That's a very big plus if you want to surgically to start and to remain involved. This is your environment. This is the environment of surgeons, and the surgeons are bosses in the operating theater. And it's a hybrid theater. TAVI is now also moving to intermediate risk patients, and financing is a big challenge in a transitional country, however you finance it. But the DRG funding would be optimal. Where it will end, will they say, okay, we will provide you all three centers with 50 valves and okay, split it in between yourself. And that's something we would probably go for that as well, just to keep the program alive, because we have a lot of patients and more and more are coming and being referred and everything, and we simply cannot treat them all. We do a lot of surgery on them, standard AVR, but not TAVI. In a healthcare system like that, it's very important to carefully select the patients to gain the optimal cost benefit, and both to keep the program alive. You don't want a bad advertising. You don't want a bad outcomes and bad advertising. Then someone will say, okay, you're spending all that money in 85 years old. You should stop doing that when we have problems with, I don't know, simpler things or cancer patients. And with this scarce financing in a country like ours, it'll probably still remain a tool just for high-risk patients. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Unic. Are there questions from the audience? Yes, please.
Nice talk and congratulations.
Thank you.
You said DRG rebound will be okay, you'll be nice.
Would be nice, to, yes. At least to cover the price of Wald.
For you or for my results. Because now in Germany they have a lot of studies. Maybe when you need to do, and maybe when surgeon is lazy, it's better to put a TAVI and go home. How to control the indication. Because, you know, I have to do surgery. I'm losing 3 or 4 hours in a operating room, and I have to follow this patient, he's bleeding or not bleeding. Mm. So in 30 minutes, you put a valve and you are going home.
Because of the limits.
It's a problem for financial, yeah?
Because of the limits in Croatia, Dr. Unic told us already, you have to be very careful where you are, which patient you should choose. And what I told Matthew or Matthias already is that you have to see how is Euroscore, for instance. You shouldn't go for a Euroscore which is higher than 40. Because, I mean, it doesn't make sense that you do a high-risk patient and she's, let's say, 83 years old, and then you're going to lose her, and even more, you're losing also the, I don't know, $30,000, whatever. So this is critical, right? I mean, you have to decide for, it's like you're having one organ or one possibility of valve, TAVI, into one patient. So you should choose a solid decision, something between 20 and 40 when you start, because you are limited. And yeah.
But another aspect in Germany is that since this year we have, from the federal government, we have a rule, a guideline, who and how patients are treated by TAVI. We have to build a heart team. We have to sign cardiac surgeon as well as cardiologist, a heart team protocol. If this is not the case, so for example, if the cardiologist is doing the indication without the surgeon, this case would never be reimbursed. So since this year, it's a very strict rule. We don't know how long this rule will last, but I think
at
3 years.
It's good.
And so this is the regulation since this year in Germany.
Yeah, and pretty important for funding, as you showed us yesterday, that the DRG reimbursement in Germany actually not only covers the expenses of everything you need for the, but you're making a profit. So
if it's profitable. If you don't have this heart team protocol, you're getting nothing at all.
But you know, it was indication for high risk patients and non operable patients.
Yes.
Certain thousand operations, it means certain thousand operations 2 years ago.
Of course.
Right.
Of course.
Therefore, it's very.
A lot of
and also money. It's also about money, as we heard. So either one side is that we are losing patients as cardiac surgeons. So that's why we are in a heart team, and both sides have to sign that they agree to the indication for TAVI. And secondly, we have to see that we don't spend too much money for it, right? I mean, that's another reason why they got stuck and made these decisions, because they can't spend more than billions in there, right? I mean, millions are already put in the market, what we heard before. So we have to be very careful what we're doing, and I think it's good to push a program to see that it's running, and once in a while you're choosing one and you see that the reimbursement does, but you also see that you don't, as Dr. Zembala told us, that you have good results. So we look out for stable patients who are running, or not running, they're moving on the ward, they're not all the time in the bed, they have the Euroscore is beneath 40, I would start with, and then you see that you get mortality very low, and also having a little fun with it, because if you have bad results, they will stop you, won't they?
And Dr. Unic, just a little question, because Michael Zembala went away. So could you explain to us how is the situation in your hospital? Are you doing transfemoral as well?
Yes.
Or are you involved, or how does it work?
We are involved in all TAVIs, and of our 65 patients, only about 10% so far were transapical
yes.
cases and two transaortic cases. Mm-hmm. All the rest is transfemoral cases.
So are you performing transfemoral cases
yes.
On
yes.
your own?
With invasive cardiologist, and mm-hmm. we change between the first and second operator. We do the femoral cut down.
That's wonderful.
We also use the ProStar mm-hmm. And femoral cut down also about half open access.
I mean, this is as long as we have such a situation, everything is fine.
Everything is fine, but. There's always tendency to move it back to the cath lab. No, we should do that there. It's better picture.
Yeah, but
we have
anyway,
everything. You know,
if you are in the business as a surgeon,
we are in the business.
And
we are not. We are dedicated not to go away from out of that business.
Yeah, please.
So,
please do so.
We have obtained the wire and catheter skills thanks to thousands of pacemakers that we put in. So we're not unfamiliar to that, just a little bit longer wire and you're coming from a different site. And it's arterial, but for other things and for potential complications and that, I think it's the optimal environment is a hybrid room and the surgeon should be involved.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And just one, yeah, very good. And in one word, to Kiel, we try to do the ones we have at the patients from the university. So they're directly sent by the cardiologist to university. They are split. So half are done surgically, and half of them, so either transapical or transaortic, and the other half is done transfemorally. Mm. So otherwise, we would have stopped the program because we can't be overruled. You have to see that you do your cases, that you see. In the next, let's say, next half of 16, you see 50%, sir.
Okay, so it's really my pleasure to introduce Professor Lutter. I'm really happy that he came because he will give us insight about what's going on currently in the transcatheter mitral business. And as I already said, he is a pioneer in this topic. He invented one of the first transcatheter mitral valve, and I'm really keen to hear his lecture.
So we don't have any TETs here for voting, but you can say, I mean, because due to the fact that we have this topic right now, I want to know whether you believe in that this might work in the future, or you think more we're coming back to the mitral valve repair, minimally invasive done, which is the gold standard right now. So hands up for the guys or women who think transcatheter mitral valve implantation will be possible in humans. So let's say it's about half. Okay, let's see. Which is good, which is classic, which I like. So my job was in 97, I started working on TAVI. At that time, everybody said, you're crazy, and still now I'm crazy because I did mitral valve implantation. In between, I invented also TAVI, 19-0 valve stent, I did first in pigs, and it's the valve stent is still with some barbs on the bottom in the museum from Irvine, California, and from Edwards. But nevertheless, I rediscussed and said, okay, TAVI is done. Everybody does TAVI already starting this century, so in 02, 03. And then I changed to mitral because nobody was at that time working on mitral. One group from Lausanne did the first in pig implantation. I said, okay, don't worry, go ahead, work on very hard. And that's what I did. And we'll see afterwards what came out of it. So. What is very interesting to see, how many patients will be available for transcatheter mitral? If you look here for the age on the y-axis, we can see the blue line is aortic, but mitral is about 75 years old patients, about 2.3-fold of what we see in TAVI. So it's much more patients running around mitral regurgitation. This is the golden standard. I told you already that's the standard in Kiel. Two fingers here in implantation of the heart lung machine into the groin, and a small opening into the right upper chest. That's what you might know, and this is very helpful for patients because you can do lots of repairs. You can do annuloplasty, you can do resections, you can do close-up clefts, etc., which you know. And but most of the mitral regurg patients with severe MR are not treated. So they're treated conservatively, classically, pharmacologically. But why? So 2%, all of them could be done by surgery. 49% of this on the right side could be done. They are candidates, but they are not operated on because of age, high operative risk, multiple comorbidities, and advanced age on the left side. So 49% are high risk, you would say. The other half is not high risk, it's not treated. 2% of them, this is a population from US, 2% are done. So you could much more acquire patients and look out, which you could treat with other procedures if you have them available, or you're more keen that you can do them in your OR. So valve and valve and valve ring is already presented, so we'll go ahead. So what about TMVI? Sometimes they call it TAMVI. I don't know what's coming up, but at least it's transcatheter mitral. That's a The challenges you might know, that's why some of you put the hands very slowly up, because it's difficult. That's why it took so long. TAVI was developed end of starting this century, and then from first implantation 03 to 7 or 8, it was about, 4 to 5 years after first implantation in Rouen, they started all over. Right now, first implantation was done already in 13. And now we have 16, and some of them are done. It's slowly starting. We'll see whether it's getting faster. But at least we had to have TAVI to get this confidence in. Because of the complexity, not circular, not 2D, sizing complex due to diastolic and systolic diameters of the annulus. It's much more soft compared to the rigid calcified tube we have in the aortic position. Fixation problem is up to now, it's a problem for many of the devices. Sealing problems, you could fail into leaks. LV caudal interaction, yes, because you have to come up with a device either from transeptal or from transapical. LV obstruction, for sure, if you have a large valve. Impact of afterload in patients with low ejection fraction. Durability, because it's a larger valve. So there are some out of them. You can see here, if you like, in European Heart Journal, we published a lot of devices here and how far they are, what they are doing. And they try to fix either from beneath, from the ventricular side, with TAVs or pedals here, with pedals, or with a neocord fixed on the apex. So what are the ones who are already in starting feasibility and safety trials? This is the Tiara from NeoWesk. You can see that this device has anchors from beneath, so some tabs from beneath, from subannular, and a nice cuff from above. The Edwards device here, Fortis, has the pedals beneath, so you have a cuff in the atrium and a cylinder in the ventricle. And we'll hear some more about the pedals. And here, the third one is the Tendyne Abbott device right now, with a button on the apex and the neocord through the ventricle and a nice cuff. So what's going on? And we have here fourth, not to forget, this is the cardiac. Cardiac comes with some struts from beneath and from above. Can you see that? I show them to you more in detail. So looking for Tiara, How does it look like? I told you already, some taps from beneath, nice cuff, taps from beneath. Here's, you can imagine about this height, you have the mitral annulus. And yeah, whether these angles will help to fix them, you'll see in a minute. The results. Here you can see from the ventricular side how these taps are going to work in the commissure and postural lateral area. Oh, this changed a little bit. So these are pre-implant, and you can see that they have so far implanted 7 tiara valves, and they only 2 of them only died after half a year and 2 months due to kidney failure, but nevertheless the other survived, and they had 2 trivials, and the other one had none MR, which is very important to see. The problem that they didn't do further, because they started already in 14, so 2 years ago, is that it's problem of sizing. It's very difficult because of the anchors to find the right size for this device, but they have so far good results. What about 12? 12 is also a startup company which is bought by Medtronic right now in summer last year, and they have also a very interesting device which is pushed here into the annulus, as you can see, and they have these very small, you might don't see them, in these romp nitinol struts, you see very small hooks which are going to hook into the annulus of the mitral valve, and so far they have these results. They lost 2 patients, but nevertheless the last 6 patients survived the SDS score. Where do we start? So mainly they have had starting male and half female, and Nuha was between 3 and 4, and STS mortality index was between 6, 10, and 8, and therefore the Euro score, you might be more familiar, so even more on the lower side than on the higher side. And as you can see here, beneath the preoperative ejection fraction was around 30 to 55. And as you can see, they had a severe MR before, and afterwards they have treated functional and also degenerative mitral regurgitation, but mainly functional, because then the LV is very dilated, and that's why they have this the severe MR more and functional. And the initial results, I told you already that they lost 2 patients after 1 and 28 days, but all the others so far are living with good results, and they have no MR, which is excellent. And yeah, we'll see on EuroPCR in Paris the next results. What about Fortis, the device with the pedals from Edwards? I worked with them a year. In 08, and they learned a lot about mitral valve implantation, but they themselves developed those pedals to fix it from beneath around the native leaflets. And how does it look like? You can imagine that they firstly come from the transapical side implant. They go inside with a delivery system in the left atrium, coming back after opening their cuff from the atrial side, and then secondly they are closing their pedals, as you can see here, and they should hold and fix those pedals, the top parts, towards the annulus. But this is difficult, what I learned, due to the fact that it starts a little moving, and also building up some thrombi, as they told me. They had a very low ejection fraction overall. It was an average 34, and yeah, so therefore the mortality rate was about 39% in those patients. That's why they didn't go ahead and bought another system, the cardiac system, which I introduce you here. It was, they did the first implantation in June 13, and it was originally a transapical device, but they did also one transfemoral already, the cardiac, and it was bought right now from Cardiac to Edwards, and they are fusing right now the systems, because also Cardiac had in the past, they had also a little trouble with these struts from beneath, from the ventricular side and from the atrial side. Here in the CT scan, you see here the struts coming from both sides, and therefore it's quite difficult to implant, but they performed it here, and you can see nicely that there's no regurgitation. Here's the space-free LVOT, and how are the results? On the next slide, here you can see that they come either from transapical and also from transseptal with this device, which makes it very interesting. That's why it was bought. And unfortunately, some of them were male positioned as this this patient here, and the survival is so half and half, I would say. So as you can see here, some of the patients, the two last ones and the first ones, are living, but in between they had a bad period, and they, due to this 50% mortality, they stopped right now, and they are fusing it right now with the Forte system from Edwards. Why did bring up this slide? Due to the fact you have to imagine that there's a major force onto the mitral valve at the time of systole, and it's even stronger compared to a rocket, which you can see here on the right. So if you compare the PSI, the power which is meant onto the mitral leaflets is higher compared to what is in one of the Saturn rockets. So we started in 07. With doing some valve stent implantations as a star. We like that shape because we had it available at that time from other protheses. We implanted here in our ventricular port this pericardial valve. And then, as you can see, it changed towards a more rounded shape, circular, with the pericardial valve stent implanted. And we started with the tether system. And we, at that time, we were the only ones who worked about it. And later, they told us, why do you use any tethers? Yeah, it's because you want to fix it. So we have three different fixation possibilities. One is the cuff in the atrium, then the little radial force in the atrium, and a nicely fixed tether, one tether right now, but we started with four. We merged in 09, 2010, so 6 years ago, with Tendine. And Tendine started, had his own program, and then we merged here at this stage. We did round laser cut by 90 nulls and oval shape, like a butterfly here, D-shaped laser of 90 null. And then we came, after a while, we came up with this Tendine valve stent. So very hard work, but so far it works very well. As you can see, we did lots of million cycles to test the durability and to finding out what is best from the material from the porcine pericardial valve, etc. So that we came up with this valve stand, which is nicely aligning, which is very important. So it's a 90 null stand with porcine pericardium, and it requires no cardiopulmonary bypass. It's retrievable, which is very good. So we had in Oslo, for instance, 2 or 3 months ago, they did two patients in Oslo, and one was too small, and they changed it and put a bigger one in, and both patients are fine. And this is the valve stent, which I showed you already, with the pad on the left atrium, left apex. So this is a transapical approach so far. Tendine is working also on a transfemoral system, but this will take a little time. And you can see right now here from the atrial side towards the ventricle, into the left ventricle, the movement of the leaflets. And we did, we were the first at that time in February 14, implanting a mitral valve stent into a patient in America with good results. This was a short-term implantation, but without cardiopulmonary bypass. The cardiac before done, 1 year before, they used cardiopulmonary bypass as a support. Very dry here. And sorry. And you can see the wedge pressure, so the ventricular and the atrial wave here. So high left atrial, this is wedge pressure before at baseline, and after implantation, you can see the drop due to the reduction of MR. And CO improved, and here on the left, you can see the major mitral regurgitation before implantation. Afterwards, that was successfully at that time. We didn't see any MR, and it fitted very well. So we did the first in man in London, Great Britain, and this 60-year-old lady. And she had a severe functional MR. She had lots of comorbidities, and she had a small aneurysm in the apex. So this had to be reduced or also treated at the time of transapical approach. Neil Mowat did it the first. I couldn't do because they said I'm conflict of interest or something because I was inventor at that time. And you can imagine there was a lemur going crossing, the rema crossing the sternum, behind the sternum to the LED. That was one of the reasons ejection fraction was okay. But there was also the pulmonary artery pressure 2/3. So we were very excited at that time, late 14, whether this will work. And what is for all is very good to do mutual sizing of CC and SL distances. And we decided to put this valve stand in and proper imaging by CT and TE. As you can see, to come perpendicular from the apex side towards the mitral annular plane. And here you can see the access to get to know which intercostal space will be the right one to do a small incision. And there was the severe MR preoperative, and it was done afterwards. And you can see it's little high up. It could have been a little lower towards the ventricle. That's what they learned. The next case is to implant it intra-annularly, not starting in the atrium, and then pulling it towards with the delivery system towards the apex. But we were keen enough to have this good result. And here you see one of the angiographies to imagine how this valve stand stays in the mitral position. Here, right now, you look onto the top of the apex. So how are the results from the first 10 patients? All of them had severe MR, and most of them had functional regurgitation. Also, three of them degenerative, so primary MR. And the age differed between 68 and 87. And they all had NUHA 3 or 4, ejection fraction between 35 and 61, so also one with 24. So, and the results were also very good at that time. They were all alive, very long alive, and we only lost one patient so far of 30 right now already. So the mortality so far is beneath 4%. And the 10 patients, it was zero at 30-day mortality. And there was only one trace here by this lady first, and then no MR at all. So we are very happy at the time. 10-9 bought this system. This is also supportive for a young startup company helping to go ahead and doing the studies. And as I told you, 28 cases in end of November 15, so we have around starting 30 patients already done. Most of them, you want to know it, in England, Sydney, Minneapolis, Dallas, New York, Chicago, so all over. And we hope that this program is running ahead, and lots to do, also more developments towards transfemoral and other prototypes. And here you can see a CT afterwards. And I've to come to the end. Fully retrievable system, as I told you. Very good hemodynamic results, because this is one of the valve stands with larger 3 square centimeters, which is extraordinary if you compare them with starting 2 centimeters of bioprosthesis in surgery. It's stable and it's well tolerated, and so far, very good results. Thank you for the pleasure of the floor.
For this very nice, I'm completely excited. Other questions? I suppose there are many questions. First of all, I would like to ask you, how long does such a procedure take? So yeah. If we compare that with this mitral valve and valve, it's a, I would say, 10 minutes procedure. How long does that take? It's difficult to deploy, difficult to position?
No.
No? It's
no.
Easy?
No, they come, usually it takes 2 hours.
Okay.
So if you have a very fat patient they had right now in, Cleveland, it took 3 hours because it was more opening and closing up was about an hour. But normally it takes 2 hours, 5 minutes. That's the usual time we have right now. And these are the learning curve. 30 patients, I mean, this is nothing.
Yeah, of
right?
course.
And I think this can also come down as a normal transapical procedure can come down to 1 hour, 5 hours.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sometimes you need 45, I need some, I say always 60 minutes. So sometimes I'm 55, or when I'm lazy, it takes me 1 hour 10 or 1 hour 15 for a transapical, for a TAVI. And this, I think this will also come down to 1 hour.
Yeah, I'm completely convinced that there is a big learning curve, and this is why I do not really understand why you do the procedures everywhere over the world and not in your own center. And after 30 cases, in how many sites?
So around about 10 or more. 10. Right now it's 15 already. Mm. Yeah, so the most have been done in Minneapolis, and it's an FDA-approved feasibility study. Mm. But it's very difficult right now with the beef farm from Bonn, Germany. They control very much everything because they had this breast stuff, silicone stuff problem in France. You might remember it. They had to be excised, all of them. And then they look for everything right now, and which is good for the patient on one hand side. On the other hand, it's bad for the patient because the ones who need it right now with the MR4 and high risk, they don't get it.
Mm.
So, but hopefully we'll start in Germany in autumn.
And you told us that the Edward system, they did it with on the pump with heart lung machine support.
Yeah, they started the cardiac. Yeah. For instance, I know the first one and the first three, I think, were started with on pump as a support, and the Fortis, I don't know. The Fortis, I think there was a problem of fixation, I think, and they told us because of thrombi, they took it back and they are going to fuse it, cardiac and the Fortis of Edwards together to make a new one, and hopefully they are lucky and getting a more stable.
There was a question here.
Stand. So, yeah.
Please.
We are also implanting more and more MitraClip. Some industries they did work a lot also on percutaneous mitral annuloplasty, but now mitral valve replacement is coming also percutaneously. What would be your philosophy, your position for the next few years?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, MitraClip works quite well also in a high risk patient cohort. And this will be difficult to decide in the future whether you should take one of the mitral valve stands or should you do a mitral clip. But as it looks like, if you do take a very efficient and a good valve, mitral valve stand, you can come up with MR0. And then it tells you if what we know from our procedures, the better your repair or the more you're on the side of MR0, then the survival curve is much better compared if you have moderate to severe MR after surgery or after mitral clip. So for sure, this is a competition on one side. On the other hand, I would say mitral clip can be done more in the higher risk cohort so far. And let's say mitral valve stent is in between minimally invasive surgery and mitral clip. So there will be a niche for each of the procedures right now. That's what I think. And we have to learn more what is better for this patient and that patient. And we will see, as we know right now from different TAVI devices, the advantages and disadvantages. And due to this finding out and discussion and having you all here on a Saturday afternoon, it's great to talk to you and discuss it. I think that's important.
Dr. Unic, please.
Right. So echo has been done the favorite guided imaging source we used at Kiel as we developed it, because I'm not an X-ray guy, because this metal is always heavy and takes time, and then you have to find the right plane, etc. So I'm an echo guy, and it was always guided by echo. But I think once in a while to do an X-ray image, so angio in between fluoroscopy is also very helpful. So far I would say, okay, mainly it can be done by echo, because you want to know exactly and right on the time whether you have any, do you see any MR, do you see any PVL, do you see how is it aligned towards the aortic root, how is it posteriorly, you can do it nicely 3D, you can switch between 2 and 3. So I'm convinced that it's more an echo procedure, and which is also helpful for yourself, for your gonads, and for the patient as well. X-ray is not good, which we have to learn, even if you do longer procedures. And once in a while, you do a fluoro, because checking, controlling, okay, is it in the right positioning? Is it lying nicely on your annulus? And what about MR, et cetera? It's just as a follow-up control, I would say. But mainly, as you said, you go for echo.
And my question to you is actually a two-part question. In one case of this case, you showed that you made the mitral valve replacement over transseptal position. Did you need a cardiologist in this situation? And do you think in the future that the cardiologist will be also a competition for us? I am so happy that you are a surgeon yourself, that you are improving this device, and I'm worried about the future that the cardiologist also will be a competence for us in such a procedure.
Yeah, but you have to see, even as a cardiac surgeon, you have, and as Dr. Zembala told us, you have to go for the competition, you have to fight, you have to do at least good results. Either you do aortic valves or transfemorals or transaortic. See that your cohort, you stay with the patient, see that they don't, I'm running always around and seeing that they don't get a pneumonia, getting the patients out of the bed, etc. You're right, this will be a competition more or less in a couple of years also with the transfemoral access. But so far, most of the devices I've showed you, they are transapical. So you're first, so use it. I mean, we could have done, at the time of TAVI, we could have done them all. We would have said, hey, guy, give me this wire into the ascending or whatever, help me with my first TAVI, and then we would have done all the TAVIs. But, I mean, as long as we sleep as surgeons and lean back and saying, oh, it works so fine, and I'm the hero, and I'm the best, etc. No, we have to fight. We have to compete, and we have to show that we are also very good, and that we're having the best or the better results, a little better than the others, then you will get the more patients compared to your competitor. I think that's all about. And and as you heard, in 97, I started with TAVI experimentally, and I said, okay, this will come up, because this is a good idea we have to fight for, and we could have done it on our own, but if they are better, they take it all over. So take it, you are young, you have to be inventive, you have to look out, and even be interested in TF, and in this I would be very much interested because it's coming up. We can't stop it. Even if I'm lost, this will come. Yeah.
There are no better words to close this session. Georg, thank you so much. It was an amazing presentation. Thank you all for coming, and I hope you learned a lot and go home and do TAVI. Thank you.